Hey, welcome back. My name is the Tech Lead and I am the Tech Lead. Today we are drinking 100% juice, pineapple banana. Pretty good, nice and sweet. I thought today we would talk about how to scale an app, like a web app or a mobile app or something like that, up to 10 million users. And I'm not gonna pretend like I know how to do this stuff. I had done it once several years ago and I'm pretty sure that I didn't do it correctly. For me, I started on a virtual hosting service where my app would be hosted on a single machine shared by many other users. And then when I found that the load was getting too much, I moved to my own server, like a 2 gigahertz, 2 gig RAM machine. And then I upgraded that all the way up to like 8 gigs, 8 cores. And then I got another database server. And then from there, I continued adding additional web servers and database servers until I had like 15 different servers I was running. And then I would need scripts to set them up because it would just take too much time to configure each server. So I'm not expecting anyone to necessarily get to this scale, but I think it's generally good to have somewhere in the back of your mind an idea of how this can be done, such that if you're building an app or site or something like that, then you can be prepared and have a mental model of what your architecture and infrastructure is going to look like to get you to that scale, should you ever need it at some point. There's usually one entry point to your site or app, and that's www.yourapp.com. And what generally people do is have this point to a load balancer. Load balancers will take that connection and route it to a number of different web servers that will actually handle the request. Now for me, I didn't actually need to use a load balancer because what I would do instead was I would set up different host names, and host names are like image.webserver.com or game.webserver.com, chat.webserver.com, and each of these couldn't point to different web servers. So I manually did the load balancing that way. And in some respects, it was simpler to do it that way because then I had one less moving part to think about. I didn't have to manage this load balancer, which not only can cost extra money, but you have to configure it correctly and it needs to manage sessions. Like generally you want a user on one IP address to always stay with a certain server. Otherwise they could be moving across the servers and cookies and sessions and things like that can get lost. The load balancer can generally get this all taken care of for you. One popular one people use is Nginx, I've heard. There's other services like the hosting company I use, SoftLayer, will just offer you like a load balancing service that you can configure through the web portal, and they just take care of all this for you. On the web server, you can just have many different web servers. These can be relatively weak machines. Not that weak. Like I run a web server that's 8 cores, 8 gigs of RAM. Each core is like 2 gigahertz or something like that. And I think that's actually probably overpowered. A lot of people run these on even weaker machines, I think. But for me, I found that if I could just throw money at the problem and just upgrade my machine to as powerful as I could make it, and in turn, I don't have to manage trying to scale up my infrastructure, then that would be worth it for me. So my approach to scaling was generally to just upgrade the hardware as powerful as I can and just use as few machines as possible, which may not be the most cost-effective way of doing things, but as a one-man show, that's how I was doing it. As you're starting out, your web server may be doing everything. Like it would act as your database server as well. It would act as your image hosting service. But over time, as you get bigger, you can actually move these into different machines. And so one way to reduce load on the web server was I would have the images served off of a separate machine. And I found that images actually add a lot of load to a web server. Even though it doesn't take much processing, it just requires holding up a connection. And so one way to manage this is you can have a CDN, which is like a content delivery network. The content delivery network is great for serving static assets like images, videos, CSS, JavaScript. What the CDN does for you is they usually have many different points scattered throughout the world, and they will copy and cache your files in that local server, like in different geographies. And so when people try to access your content, it's much faster to get that content. The first fetch for your content may be a little bit slower because that CDN point will need to fetch the data from your local server. But after that, it's cached, and then all the other requests are very fast. And not only that, it reduces load on your web servers. So one of the first things I usually do is to set up a CDN and just have all my images served from that. From the web server, you usually issue requests into your database server. But before you do that, you can actually issue that request to a caching layer. Now, caching layers are generally implemented through something like Memcache, Redis, Cassandra, something like that. And what these do is they reduce load on your database server. The caching service is sometimes hosted on the same server as the web server, but it can also be a separate machine as well. And what you want to do is put heavy queries, like complicated joins and stuff like that, you put those inside this caching service so that your database is only hit every few hours or so when you want to update that data. But most of the time, it would just be hitting that cache first. These caching services can also be used for short-term temporary data, like if you want to remember some status of a user or something for 10 seconds or something like that, then you could use this caching service. It's just a quick way to store data without actually hitting a database layer. One issue I hit with web servers quite often is they would hit their maximum number of connections. Like for Apache, it's like 1,000 connections or something like that. And you can try to raise that limit, but that's not really the right way to handle this. If you're hitting your maximum number of connections, probably the reason is that you're holding your database connection open too long, your database queries are slow, and the real solution for this is going to be to optimize your queries so that you're not holding onto connections very long. There are scenarios where if you're implementing like a real-time chat or something, you're going to need to hold onto connections longer than you should expect to, and the right structure, I believe, for this would be to use something like Node.js, Golang, Elixir, some language that's optimized for managing multiple concurrent sessions at the same time. So like Apache is not very good at real-time services. If you're doing image hosting or something like that, you may find that you're starting to run out of space on your web server. And one trick you can do is use symbolic links to remote mount a file system, like your upload server or something like that. And that pretty much allows you to have infinite disk space because you can just keep mounting additional remote points that connect to other file systems. Now, the primary concern generally for scaling is going to be in your database server. And before anything else fails, it's quite likely that your database server will be the first to collapse and then your whole site will go down. And getting this database server right is the most important part, I think. The first thing I would do is make sure that all my database queries are well optimized and indexed. So you should be using keys and indices and make sure that every query you make is going to be using some key or index. That will keep your queries optimized. You want to keep your queries simple. And for me, I like to generally avoid joins on the table side. Like I would just do the join manually on the web server side just to avoid that additional load on the database server if I can. So I like to keep all my queries very simple. If there's anything that requires putting load or calculations on the database, I like to just have that pre-computed by like a cron job or something and then insert it into the database as a separate table and have that pre-calculated. So the key to this is to keep your queries so simple. All it is it's almost like just a lookup. If you're issuing queries to count the number of friends a user has or something like that, that's probably already too much load on the server, I think. And instead, what you want is a table that just increments once every time a user's friend goes up or down or something like that. If you know that your queries are well indexed, then the next step I would take would be to just upgrade your database server as much as you can hardware-wise to the point that it makes sense. Like my database server has 16 cores and 16 gigs of RAM, and these days you can increase the RAM even more. The more RAM you have, the better chance your database will be stored completely in memory, and then that just makes the queries faster. One of the first things I like to do is set up master-slave database replication. And what this is you have two database servers and one is copying from the other. And they're basically copies of each other, but there's a little lag in between. Now, the master is the source of truth, and that's what you write into. The slave is a copy and you can read from it, but you never write into it. And the reason this is good is oftentimes you don't need consistency. So you can just read from the slave and that helps spread the load. But you would always write into the master. So this master should only handle writes and anytime you need like a consistent read. It helps spread the load. And not only that, but by having at least one slave server that is a copy of the master, using that one slave, you can easily copy it and create multiple other slave servers. If you did not have that slave server, then it's very difficult to get started setting up a new slave server, because the only way to do that would be to pause the master database, take the whole website down, make a copy of it, and then bring everything back up online. And that's a huge amount of downtime that you really don't want. Like it could take 10 to 20 hours if you're copying large amounts of data. It could take even longer than that. Another thing people will do is they'll do database sharding, where they'll split up the users. So they'll take like the user ID, mod it by 10, and depending on that, they'll send it to one of 10 different database servers. And another type of sharding that people may do is they will simply just take tables that are not connected, like a chat table and a message board table and a user ID table, and they'll just have different servers for each of those. But essentially using this sort of setup, I was able to get 10 to 15 high-end servers managing about 10 million users. About half of them would be web servers, half of them would be database servers. Of the database servers, half would be masters, half would be slave servers. I actually had some of the web servers replicating from the masters to serve as backups. For me, I had Memcache running on all the web servers so that they could act as a caching layer. I had CDN set up. I did my own manual load balancing, so I didn't need that. I had used symbolic links to mount remote file systems such that I didn't run out of disk space. I did user sharding based on the system where I had a master table that indicated which user belonged to which server. And then I could move users around servers if I needed to using a script. If I noticed like one server was starting to get overloaded or something like that. Other services like Amazon Web Services or Google App Engine can also help you scale automatically in certain ways, but I generally avoid those because they involve getting you locked up into their system and the costs are kind of high sometimes. So that'll do it for me. I think what you want to keep in mind is, as an application developer, to at least never hard code in the endpoints for your database server, image server, web server, chat server, any of this stuff. Like, it should be in variables at least so that you can quickly change them to other endpoints if you need to. That can help you quickly distribute load. And in the back of your mind now, you should at least probably perhaps have an idea about how the whole system and architecture can scale up to many more millions of users if you ever need to. But this is just the way that I did things. Let me know how you guys scale things, what your thoughts are. Maybe there's better ideas about how to do this stuff. I'm very curious to hear your guys' thoughts. If you like this video, give it a like and subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye.